This goes wisdom. Trolls have used all the phone credits for the month. Yep. The wee packages of smack will be getting £2.50 worth removed each drop. The majority of these trolls are on antipsychotic medicines, probably ex-addicts of some substance. Because, you know, how else are you going to get dipshits to defend cult religious nonsense? You would have to target people with habits, like a junkie. Anybody in any of these kind of substance abuses or dependencies, they don't want to be locked up for even one day, never mind a weekend or a week. So they will bend over backwards and spew any crap and get themselves involved in anything in order to avoid that kind of situation. So these chaps that phone us up, the Chrissies and all these other dipshits from, you know, the Globe cult, that's exactly what they are. They're addicts with a dependency, get themselves into a bit of bother, and now they have to spew utter crap. MK controlled mental patients, very well, they might very well be. I think the vast populace is under that kind of MK control, trauma-based mind control. They've been robbed of the psychological and emotional foundations of where they actually are and been traumatised left, right and centre. You know, it's no wonder they accept fucking war, famine, bullshit, abuse, abuse of animals, abuse of infants, abuse of adults. You know, it's a fucking shit state. This Globe cult has got people in a right mess. Yes, I play guitar. Well, I try. Would you like a song? I don't know what's going on in the chat here. I don't know what he's discussing. Right. Constance Burns, beyond the magic curve. Globe shite took away our north. Man, we were lost at sea. Now we found our way homeward. Well, let's hope so, Constance Burns. Or Bruns, Burns, Bruns. AB Dell, do you believe that before us there lived ancient civilization? Oh, shit. Or this is one big lie. I'm not sure about that, to be honest with you. I keep saying, you know, this history and 2,000 years ago and 10,000 years ago such and such happened and fucking... I don't know. I don't know the real history of this place. I think this era that we are in is a lot shorter when people realise... You know, I'm not even giving it 500 years. I highly doubt that's the case. You know, the way that we advance so quickly and the way things are advancing at ever more rapid rate tells me that, you know, in the last 60 years we've had huge movement and upheaval, you know, compared to, you know, whatever long they want to tell us before that. It just doesn't add up. So, I don't know. I keep getting that kind of feeling, I keep hinting at it. When we go, the reason that we have these reductionist, materialistic philosophies and sciences of existence and what happened before is, you know, it's like trying to tie us to, fuck, I just had a brain fart, I don't even know what the fuck I'm saying now. It's gone. I'll come back to it if I remember. What was the question again? Aye, civilizations, blah, blah, blah. Aye, that was my point. I keep hinting at it. You know, we've got these nonsense stories about life and evolution and the different cultures and the complexities of life all coming from, you know, common ancestors and, you know, came from fucking soup. To me, it's just utter bullshit. So the questions have to be asked then, well, you know, how do we get all these different races of people? How do we get all this complexity of life, animal life, insect life, the whole lot? You know, and that's what I'm saying, you know, there's a possibility there that different aspects of life come from different areas and somehow have ended up here, either through, you know, different mechanisms that you could postulate, that, you know, infiltration, other life forms messing with other life forms, you know, cataclysmic events that forced us into this area. There's so many possibilities. I don't know. I've got a visitor.
How you doing, Dell? It's Joshua.
How you doing, Joshua? All right.
I'm doing pretty well. I was doing a live stream before yours, videotaping all of the snowflakes at Washington, D.C., whining about gun control.
Nice.
Yeah, what do you think about that? What do you think about what's going on over here with the school shootings and them kind of pushing a clear agenda? Because I say it's an agenda because with the quote protests that they had in Washington, D.C. and six other states, they had it said students plan protest. But in Washington, D.C., they had like six or seven big time artists, you know, singing their songs and stuff. So it's like, how did these students get these like Miley Cyrus to come here? Did they pool all their money together and get a GoFundMe page or what? Like, who's really running the show?
Yeah.
So what do you think about that?
Okay, it's the same stuff. It's just ridiculous, mate. It's let's blame an inanimate object rather than get to the root of the real issues. If, you know, it was a real situation where kids were going off in one and firing guns into a school, I'm postulating if, then surely you would be looking at the mechanisms of how that came about and what their psychology is and how it led up to that point, rather than just, oh, it's this inanimate object's fault, let's get rid of that. You know, obviously, this is a total lunacy, so it tells you that there's an agenda, you know?
Yeah. I kind of feel the same way. Bullets kill people, not guns, so they already got that kind of more mind control of, we need to get rid of the guns. Well,
it was people.
I said this.
People kill people. You don't need a gun. And if you take away the guns, then what? They're going to use knives. So you take away the knives, what are they going to use next? They're going to use a rock. Take away the rock, they'll find something. You know?
Yeah, exactly. It's definitely a people problem. Big issue is, let's even take it for face value. Let's say that there are really kids shooting up schools. Where are the parents? Like, should these kids... Clearly, the parents are not involved in these children's lives, and they have allowed the state and TV and movies and music to basically raise their kids nowadays because the mom and dad are working 40 hours a week.
Exactly, mate. No, again, you know,
so
symptoms of this dysfunctional cult that we live in. You know, it's exactly what it is.
It's really disappointing.
Yeah.
How it's gotten this far. Mm-hmm. And I've said this too. I say this quite often when I talk about the whole gun control issue is from the age of 13 to you're 18, you need to take a course on how to use a gun, hold it in your hand, shoot it, and respect it. Now, when you turn 18 and it's legal for you to buy a gun here, you can buy one or not. But we have cooking classes so you don't burn your house down in schools. You know, we have all these other opportunities for kids to learn trades, cut wood. You know, you're in a shop class and you're cutting plywood next to a bandsaw that could cut your finger off easily. You know, so what's the big deal with teaching kids how to respect guns and shoot them and take them to the fire range? You know, it's part of our law, so I can't see too many parents just saying, oh, no, you're not allowed to go there. I think it should still be the child's choice to respect guns and learn to shoot one, and then they can decide from there. But clearly there's an agenda where the establishment doesn't want children to respect a gun. They want to fear it because that's the unknown. You know, what's the number one thing that people are afraid of? The unknown, things that they are unfamiliar to them, things that they don't understand, things that the places that they've never gone to, and things that they've never done. So I think that would be a good opportunity, you know, but if I was president, that certainly wouldn't fly. I wouldn't even be able to get to that point in the first place. But
well, you know, I'm just of that ilk where if one gun exists, you know, and it's going to be produced and put out there, then everybody should have access to that, you know, because it evens the playing field. Because what's the obviously the agenda is simple. You know, it's the same here in the UK, right down to the point where they banned air rifles, you know, potato guns, you know, I mean, but yet you've got military and police who are arming themselves to the teeth, you know, and other people right. have access to these weapons. So, you know, what's the best deterrent? Well, if there's going to be one gun, everybody should have access to it.
Yeah, how are we supposed to protect ourselves when we got a knife and you got a gun? Okay, now I got a handgun, but you got an assault rifle. Okay, now I got an assault rifle, but you got a bazooka. Okay, now I got a bazooka, you got a tank. You know, and so it's just like they're clearly trying to keep us as civilians at just two or three steps behind and not give us the ability to protect ourselves, which is what the Second Amendment is for. It's not to protect your Xbox One or your 60-inch TV or your leather couch in your house or your computer and so on and so on. Second Amendment is to protect you against your own government. And so if they start to impede on that, which they clearly already have in the school system by telling us lies about who we are, where we live, and why we're here, then that's going to continue to branch out into other areas where these snowflakes that I saw on TV are just going to say, yes, sir, three bags full, sir, whatever you say, you know, just kind of going along with the company line. And it's clear brainwashing and it's clear mind control. And it's unfortunate that these kids are so afraid to hear the word, you know, level motionless plane, flat earth, you don't live on a spinning wet ball rocket, you know, because that's all taught by authority. That's all taught by their superiors.
Yeah.
And so I think that what the establishment is able to use, you, John Smith, me, and other people that are starting to get their confidence up enough to talk to the public about this issue, is they're able to really get a good barometer of what the public thinks, because we've dealt with trolls online. We've had the emails, we've had, you know, the messages sent to us, and it's like, that's great. You can say that and more power to you, but are you going to call me that to my face on camera? Most likely not, you know? So it's like, there's this barrier between the computer and the internets and the issues at hand.
Yeah.
But when we bring it to the public, and we talk to kids and parents and college age kids about this idea, some are more susceptible to it. Some will actually listen. And I think that those are the types of kids that we need to focus on and stop worrying about the drama that can come with, you know, saying the earth is flat and expecting some kind of a reaction out of somebody. Yeah, that's planting a seed. But there's also the other side of the coin where don't cast your pearls to swine. You know, don't waste your breath and continue to try to give wisdom to somebody that's so stubborn, prideful, and arrogant and has a big ego that no matter how you would bring it to their attention,
that's it.
With a cupcake, here's a cupcake, you know, and with the little cherry on top and, you know, sugar and spice and everything nice, and they'll still eat it, and then they'll come after you, you know, so they'll take that from you, and then they'll punch you in the face for even addressing it, and how dare you say that my education is a lie.
That's why I always say to people, there's a bit of discernment that comes with it, you know, and for me, I have a knack for that, where I can recognize where I can apply it and where it's a fruitless endeavor. You know, so it just becomes a matter of people, you know, as the caller beyond belief said, you know, people need to sharpen their tools in order to realise these things and learn the lessons, and no waste their time with people that don't deserve it. You know, if they want to learn and they want to have an open mind to it, they will come to it. But is it, again, you know, if people are setting out with the attitude of converting, then you're going to end up in a bit of bother with that. Try and identify the people that you think are susceptible to it and have the conversations there, you know?
Right. Yep. Yeah, and even when I just hold a sign, I get vitriol and name-calling and stuff. You know, it's like, I'm just holding a sign saying, hey, check out Flat Earth, you know, Google, we don't live on a spinning ball, you know, stuff like that. And it's like,
I think
kids read that.
I kind of avoided that myself because you're opening up for that when you hold a sign, you know, because it's like when you're engaging with somebody and you get them on camera, there's a different demeanor to them, there's a different response because they're aware of the situation that they're in, they're being filmed, they're engaging with you one-to-one, whereas if you're standing there with a sign, it's the same when I was in the city centre with the scientist outfit on, you know, you're an easy focal point of ridicule and people just to throw insults at you, you know, because you're offering that. But when you're engaging them one-to-one without any of that, the props or the triggers, then it's a different process that happens. So if people are going out there with signs, then you have to expect that. It's going to come because it's easy for people just to throw shit at you. You know, you're just a symbol of ridicule for them and that's it.
Yeah, and I've definitely watched what you and John Smith, the new guy, Flat Earth Fokker, I don't know if you're familiar with him. Not a fan of his name. I mean, we got to try to get the swear words out of our names if that's how we're going to present this idea. We need to be, now I'm not saying you need to wear a three-piece suit or anything, but this is a serious matter, and I just think it should be taken seriously. So, you know, use your name, you know, and to use a swear word in your channel name and to say it out loud in public, it kind of just doesn't hold a lot of weight. That's just my opinion. You know, that's, you know, I'm not trying to say, tell people how to run their show, go about their business or anything. But with that being said, yeah, I'm changing up a lot of ideas and I'm coming across a lot of different ways to approach how to draw people in. And because, yeah, it's a good understanding to know that there are people out there that do take their education seriously, and even those that don't think that they have a good idea of where they live, who they are, where they come from, and why they're here. And that has all been created by the state. And I don't think that there's any way that we can convey that message until they have a teachable spirit. And there's a lot of older people, particularly men, that don't have a teachable spirit. They're very prideful and arrogant, and they think that they know it all. And to be able to sit them down and talk to them, I think that I'm not a mentor, you know, I wouldn't call myself a teacher per se, but I would say, like, hey, I could probably sit down with you and introduce some things, but I don't want you to be dependent on me. Like, I think that we here that are doing the open air activism are planting a seed and allowing them to find it on their own time, you know, and be led to that. Do you think that's kind of what we're here for?
Well, that's my whole approach, mate. It's just to be as indirect and as don't be imposing at all in any way, shape or form. And just try and engage through, you know, rational discussion and dialogue with people and hope that you can make some points, as you know, I've said, with the Socratic method, by being indirect. I think it's the best approach because it's not just men, you have women as well who are prideful and don't want to be admitting that they were duped. I don't think anybody wants to admit they're wrong, you know, or that they've overlooked something. So it's a delicate process, especially if you're being active, and how you get that seed implanted. And if you try and implant that seed and the engaging aspect is no constructive, then these people are probably going to get away with their pride and their arrogance and just dismiss you through anger, you know. So it's a delicate process of how you approach people with the activism, you know. But I mean, if people can withstand the ridicule, the signs and that kind of activism is great, because if it's repeated over and over, then eventually those seeds will get into people. There may be people on a high street who don't pay any attention to you or anybody else, but these signs that they're seeing subliminally are going to be in there, and hopefully it starts a process. But it's exactly as you say. I'm not here to convert. I'm not here to lead or save anybody. The only thing I can hope to achieve is just to affect some change in people, and that's it. And if that has to be subtle and is indirect, then that's the methods I'm going to use, you know, because that's how important it is. I'm not interested in accolades or being the saviour or the one who converted and changed people. Not interested in any of that. I've got my selfish reasons for this. My selfish reasons are I want to find out where I'm for me. So I need to be very tactful and considered in my approach to how I'm going to achieve that, you know?
Right. Yeah. And I agree. I agree with that, because there does come to a point where when you're doing this activism out in the public, you do have to have a second layer of skin, kind of an alligator type skin, where you can, in armor, where you can just kind of bat off all the fiery darts that are coming at you. But I've noticed that there are times for me, and this is just human nature, I guess, just, and maybe it's just my own personal experiences, but there is a part of us that does want to see some fruit, you know, from it, because you're just like,
yeah,
you're talking to these people and this, that, and the other. And so I totally hear where you're coming from, but there is always like that hope down deep in your heart where you're just like, you know, like 2 years ago when you talk to somebody, you'd love to have somebody, you know, send you a message and say, hey, you know, I get what you're saying. Yeah. Not 100% on board, but I certainly am not where I was when you first talked to me.
Yeah.
And that type of stuff would be encouraging. But yeah, we understand where we're at. We understood our role when we, you know, took that calling, if you will.
Yeah.
And we don't expect that, but that's not what love is. Love is unconditional. We go out there knowing that, hey, you know what? We might not ever know until never, you know? So
I think though you should take some you can take something away from it. I mean, look at the last few years and how much it's changed. Obviously you'll have seen the growth and the amount of people who have came on board with it. So things, they move forward. I think that, again, we just get impatient and frustrated that it's not happening quick enough. But my rewards, you know, I appreciate, you know, somebody, you know, like I've had a couple of people tonight just appreciating your effort and your endeavours. And I think that's what we look for as human beings, just for people to recognise our efforts. And that's it. Not to put us up on a pedestal and to stroke your egos. Just a nod of appreciation is enough to fuel us to keep us going, you know, and want to keep doing it and want to do more of it. And as long as people are sharing that between each other, then it keeps enthusiasm, it keeps people pushing forward. Huh?
Yeah, I think about, I that's a good point, because I think about that with the community that we're in, you know, whatever you want to call it, truth community, the commonwealth of flat earth, if you will. But, you know, it's the same thing with Christians and missionaries. You know, there's a lot of Christians that would love to do missions work overseas here in this country or your country and go to a less fortunate area, but they have family, work, they're just not able to go.
Yeah.
So what they do is they pray or they give out financially, and they say, hey, you know what, I appreciate what you're doing. I wish I could do it myself, or I wish I had the confidence or the physicality or the tactfulness to communicate the message, but that's just not me. But I appreciate what you're doing. So we shouldn't negate what we hear from our own community and the people that we're a part of, because I think sometimes people who do open air activism, or particularly on this topic, I mean, this is the most controversial subject, more so than gun control. Gun control is still third place to this. And I think that we need to covet those times when our own like-minded humans appreciate what we're doing, because we do sometimes try to kind of lose track of that. We say, gosh, you know, I talked to somebody, you know, a year ago, and it was a great conversation and so on and so on. I wonder where they're at. And yeah, it's good to think about those conversations that you experienced, you know, last year, but you know, you got to just keep going ahead. You got to keep pushing forward, because it's always the next person you talk to, you got to be on your game and remind yourself, you know, this is why I'm doing it, because of this person, this is a brand new thing. And for a lot of us in this community, it sounds like reruns, the way that we approach or the way that we communicate, even though every person's different, there's still kind of a script, if you will, a way to communicate the two or three truths that we know that the earth is a level motionless plane. And so we just got to make sure that we encourage each other, because, and then the new people that come in, we got to embrace those new people and take it for what they're worth. If they're genuine, they'll stay in the community. And if they're not, then, you know, let them go and do their own thing.
Exactly.
Let them learn on their own.
That's it, man. That's it. Just keep pushing on, keep pushing forward. As you say, you know, there's many people out there with different attributes and skills that I appreciate and name. You know, we're in a position that we do what we do, you know, and everybody's get each to their own, you know. So
yeah, what have you found recently? Have you found any new approaches, or just new how is it that you approach people? Because we see kind of, it's just the time when you're sitting down with somebody. Give us like an example of how you approach, you know, somebody so that you would draw them in. Is it a question? Is it something you do or what?
Again, before I even get to that, I have to be on my toes and I have to be aware. So I'm scanning and I'm looking for eye contact. I'm looking for certain body languages from people. You know, because I've refined it, you know, not only, you know, not just in this aspect, way before in other aspects of my life, I was refining the kind of things for different reasons. So I'll approach somebody and I'll just say, listen, you know, I'm a content maker on YouTube. I'm asking the general public some questions. You know, I'm looking to see if you would maybe take part in it, be on video. They'll probably ask me, you know, what's it about? They'll say, well, it's about common sense, the world we live in. Have you heard about certain subjects, blah, blah, blah. Can I lay a wee bit out for them? Assure them that I'm not there to take the piss out of them. And, you know, if they say, yeah, bang, the camera's on straight away. They say, no. Sometimes I speak to people that will say they want to engage with me, but they don't want to be on camera, which is fine. So I get through my processes of knockbacks and people being abrupt and ignorant and stuff. It's just because I don't have the camera on continuously, you know, but for different reasons, because I don't have a lot of battery power in it and whatever else. But, you know, that's pretty much it. Approach people with respect and manners and ask them if they would be willing to engage with you. I mean, that's it. It's as simple as that. But there's a process of me scanning. I can tell with certain people, just their demeanor, their body language, that it's pointless me even engaging with them, you know?
Yeah, I know that much. Yeah, so that's good to hear. It's good to know that I, you know, mm-hmm. I'll steal some of that from you. I'm just letting you know, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's good to hear that from you, and I hope that helps encourage other people too out in the community to, mm-hmm. because this is definitely an organic grassroots idea that we need to present to people, much like you were saying before, you know, give your kids evolution and give your kids creationism, you know, I mean, give them globe, give them flat earth, you know, so give them veganism, give them meat.
Yeah.
And then I think through our own discernment as we get older, we try to start to hone in on who we are and what we're about and why we're here. And we don't need to worry about what other people think, because I think if a person's, you know, whatever it is, faiths, beliefs, ideas, worldview, or whatever, it's not going to be shook when somebody comes up and presents the earth being a level motionless plane and water is our best way to observe that. And so clearly when we come up against people that have the foaming at the mouth and the saliva coming off of their teeth when you present that idea, or even just say it out loud, their worldview isn't solid. Because what their worldview is based on is a lie.
Yeah.
So it's not anything that can be taken with a grain of salt. If you put that in the blast furnace, it's and you turn off the fire, there's not going to be anything left. But if you put truth inside of, you know, a crematorium, for example, that truth is going to withstand the fire, and you're going to be left with pure gold. And so that's how we know that what we're doing is meant to be right now. We're at the cusp, and we're at the front lines of this, you know, this lie. Difficult to convey to people how deceived we have all been, and we continually are.
Yeah.
And to have this new, you know, flat earthers embrace this idea 6 weeks ago that there's no jet fuel on airplanes, you know. So what do you think about that? It's like, is it like, hey, this sounds crazy. There's no jet fuel on airplanes. Yeah. They're all gliders and they run on compressed air. Let's give it to the flat earth community and let's see what they do with it.
I think that's always the same sensational, you know, something new that because this is the thing. It's like people are just, I think they're just waiting at the screen for some new zinger, some new fantastical narrative to come at them where they can be stimulated and thinking about it. It gives them a talking points among their friends. You know, I think people just latch onto these things rather than just sitting back, assessing it, pursuing, as we always say, direct realism, empower yourself, see what you can find out for yourself, make your decisions on your own merits and know what anybody else is telling you. But it's the same thing. Things are pushed and then they're mirrored and then everybody's talking about it and then there's debates and everybody's getting an opinion and nothing is ever resolved. Let's just get the fundamentals. Let's understand the mechanics of how these things actually work and see what the proofs actually are, you know? But people don't. They just jump on it. And it sounds amazing. It sounds different and it's new. So it's got merit when it may have no merit whatsoever. It's just, you know, something fantastical to capture your imagination, you know? But as I say, I'm not even going to get in there with the jet fuel thing, you know. As far as I'm concerned, fuels are required for ignition and combustion and to make things move. That's not to say that they've not refined a process to use a minimal amount of fuel. I mean, I could get on board with that, but there's so many other aspects that people just see it in aeroplanes. You go, well, wait a minute, you know, turbines are used in different sports. You know, I watch like Formula Boat Racing, where it's the wee boats that get around the track really quickly. I mean, they're not running on compressed air. You know, none of these things is running on compressed air. It's just a sensational story, the same as the rest of them, that people latch onto. And there's no merit to it, and it can cause issues with the real stuff that we're trying to pursue, like the Earth's not a fucking globe. Now, if people are attaching that, these different labels to flat earthers or globe deniers, then you've got all that shit you wade through with people, you know, because people, the general populace generalise, you know, they adopt straw men, they attach straw men to you, they generalise over you. Communication becomes so saturated that you have to wade through all the preconceived ideas, the assumptions, in order to eradicate them before you can get to an actual rational conversation with anybody. So I don't agree with any of that. I think people should just hold back and not jump on board with these stupid ideas.
But. Yeah, I agree. And I've seen those boat races. They cruise, man. They are not your paddle boats, if you will, and those things go fast. And it's like, I think it's more wood for the already burning bonfire that's going on. And it's not going to increase the heat of what's going on right now, in my opinion, with this whole jet fuel hose. Cause it's kind of like, see, look what the government's doing now. Told you, you know, they're hiding everything from us. What, you know, now they're hiding. And it's just like,
it's just a distraction.
Yeah, I get it. I get it, yeah, and I think it is too. I think it is quite a bit of a distraction for a lot of people.
Why are all these so-called truth factions not highlighting real, tangible things? Like, hang on, the new they actually did remove this methodology of teaching for how your mind works and how we can lay out the mind and how if we apply this, nobody's going to get away with telling lies. I mean, where are all these truth factions who are promoting stuff like the real nuts and bolts of how we ended up in this situation and how we can eradicate it? They're not interested in that. They're just interested in sensational, you know, clickbaits and subscribers and likes and monetary gain. And they don't really, they're not interested in empowering people or getting to the real nut and bolts of the situation, you know? So I've always got an issue with that. Yeah. If I see any of these pushing fucking no jet fuel or no forests and stuff, I'm going, well, wait a minute, why are you not looking at, you know, the fact that they removed things like the trivium from the mainstream education, the actual tools that people require in order to discern lies and bullshit so that they're truly empowered and knowledgeable? What about that? That's a huge conspiracy that's actually factual, that's tangible, that you can see. I mean, why are you not discussing that? So...
I get it. Yeah, critical thinking in schools nowadays is like it's a fairy tale now. It's not even something that kids can do on their own anymore.
Yeah.
They can't critical think. They can't and it's almost like there are so many terms against critical thinkers, conspiracy theorists, you know, and you're not allowed to question authority. You're not allowed to say, "Hey, how did you get to that?" And why did you come to that conclusion right away?
Yeah.
And so I think a lot of people's worldviews are starting to be formed by the state. And I think people take their education in high school and everything that kind of goes along with the state providing us our knowledge about the way things work and the things that we don't understand. Well, we've promoted scientists, right? Like I'm not saying like this for everybody, but like, I'm just too lazy. Like, yeah, I'm smart, but you know, I got pregnant and I just couldn't pursue the career that I wanted to, found out that I was going to be, you know, a mom and now I have a family. And so we just couldn't pursue that. So I just take the scientist's word for it and the establishment's word for it, for what they're providing me on the information about, you know, where we live on a ball earth.
Yeah.
Like, why would they lie to me? Like, if I was in that position, I wouldn't lie.
Yeah.
And that's the thing is, like, I think too many people have their own moral code and their worldview. And most people are good people. They're not murderers and habitual liars, thieves, and so on and so on. So they have this moral code about them that they can't present onto the people that we've put in power.
Yeah.
Like, I will never lie, so how is it that they are?
Exactly. They just project what they expect. Spoke about that before. Too many people, that's what blinds them to deception and manipulation, because they think, well, I wouldn't do that, so nobody else will do it to me, which is totally irrational and illogical to have that stance, you know? But I think, you know, even at that, you know, we're talking about these people are good, they're no murderers, they're no rapists, they're no this, that, and the other. But what I could put in there is that, well, these people are ignorant. So, you know, for me, yeah, you know, they're up there. It's just, there's no way to justify that. There's no way to, you know, remove, oh, well, I've got a family and I've got a job. Well, that doesn't justify you being ignorant to your existence. It's just, as you say, it's pure laziness, you know? And it comes down to a choice. You know, you can be ignorant of the world you're living in and your experience, or you can start picking through it and try to understand it, and it's just simply a choice, mate, you know?
But yeah, most likely if you research stuff, like earlier today there was a kid who did a speech, you know, during this quote protest, and he said, I have a phone, I have this. You can research anything you want. You can learn anything you want on this. And of course he's, you know, promoting, you know, gun control and so on and so on. And I'm like, that's one of the most honest things that anybody said all day, is that you can, but people are lazy. They are ignorant. And a very powerful man in World War II said, the governments rely on the ignorance of its people.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
but,
and yeah, as ignorant as they get to be, they use the state as a means to perpetuate their ignorance.
Yeah,
by, well, giving them just enough to make them think they're smart.
That's it. I think the ignorance has been nurtured through different mechanisms, as I've said, through the education system and the family unit, you know, TV, you know, pop culture, idol culture. Ignorance has been nurtured and bred into people, you know.
Yeah. Well, I'll start heading out here. It was really great talking to you. In regards to what we were talking about with the school and just ignorance and mind control, I have a video on my channel that I re-uploaded. I mirrored talking about, you know, MK Ultra and voice to skull and their ability to use microwaves and cell phone towers to influence a group of people. And it is documented by our military in the United States that they use such technology in the past to influence people to lay down their guns. And that's just more of an example of where this country is really going, because in the future, they're not going to need this type of technology. I think it's there for them to use, but clearly we've seen our youth being indoctrinated and kind of brainwashed with repetitive regurgitation over and over again, that what they are learning is true, where in fact that, you know, it just isn't all what it's cracked up to be. So I'll do some more stuff in the future, and check out my channel, guys, Authentic Intent.
Excellent. Well, just as you say, mate, as you say, it's repetition is what has brought this about. So it's the same for us. We have to be repetitive in our approach and putting the information out there and engaging with people. Repetition, keep it up. Eventually, you know, people will come around to it. It's just the same tools, same methods that we have to employ, you know. So good on you, man.
Yeah, you too. I really appreciate what you do over there. And gosh, you know, if we come across some money, I'd love to head out there and cause some trouble with you.
Aye. Be good, mate. Be good.
All right, man. Yeah, you too. Cheers.
Take care, buddy. Right.
Yeah. So you're right, though. RussianVids should be with you in a sec, man.
No bother, cool. Thanks, man. Right, got a couple of messages here I'll read out before any guests arrive, hopefully. Dom Yamaha. Oh, cheers, Dom Yamaha. Hi, mate, it's Greg, stationed with plane. Look how far we've come with regards to numbers. In the last year, it's took off big time. You can continue to help and inspire people. Long may it continue. Look forward to seeing you all again in Paisley. And a message to the people in chat. Thank you for the continued support in this mother of all deceptions. I wouldn't be here without the support you all show on me and one another. Let's make 2018 a belter of a year. Cheers, Greg, mate. Somebody here. RussianVids, how are you doing, mate?
Good, man. Good.
Sorry, you broke. You there, bud?
You got a little bit of
a... Aye. Is it, so what do I call you, RussianVids? What's your name, mate? Is it just...
I got good, man.
RussianVids is good for you.
Oh, dude.
Nice one. You're breaking up quite bad there, man.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know why I'm getting the echo. Is it gone?
It seems to be clearing as you go on a wee bit there.
Okay.
It seems to be all right now.
Yeah. Well, anyways, Del, glad to finally talk. Of course, watch your videos. I love your, you know, going out in the streets and teaching people the flat earth truth. That's important, you know, and the way you do it, there's no messing around. And, you know your stuff and very confident because you know your stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and that's very important. And that's what I tell people. If you're going to go out there talking about flat earth, you got to know your stuff. Like I said before, you know, for the people that believe in the ball earth, ask them, what are the so-called dimensions, the radius, the diameter, the circumference of the so-called ball earth you live on? Yeah. When they can't answer that, you got them right there. So, you got them in a handicapped position like, whoa, I can't even answer that. How far is the moon? They don't know. But they're so sure about what they believe in. But they know nothing about what they believe in. So when you put them in that position, maybe they'll start listening a little bit, you know? So, but first off, I want to thank Roxanne too. Roxanne, She's the one that chimed in on my channel that I just restarted. A new channel. I've been shut down countless amount of times, and she made me aware of the time in the UK where you have your chat. And there's many topics I want to talk about. The meat eating versus, say, vegetarian, being a vegetarian or a vegan, and the March for Our Lives, and, of course, Flat Earth. Yeah. And I really want to talk about, you know, people that believe we, you know, believe we evolved and we're a higher animal. You know, all these animals, if we're a higher animal, then why aren't we eating, you know, animals as animals, raw, uncooked? Why aren't these animals, why don't you see like a lion with a match in a pot or a pan cooking up food? If we try to eat raw food, consume raw food, what's going to happen to us?
Yeah, I think it's I think it comes down to a taste preference. I think it's habits that have been cultured, and people have become accustomed to tastes and different things, you know.
Well, Pat, I'm sorry, Del. You know, the thing is this. What are they pushing? How many vegetarian restaurants are on the fast food level? You got Burger King, you got McDonald's, KFC. It's all pushing eating meat. You know, whatever they're pushing, don't buy. So that's the pushing. Bacon, bacon. Everybody loves bacon. That's what they're pushing. Yeah. I'm not pushing eating fruits and vegetables. That just tells you right there, you know, it's like, you know, like anything else, you know, that's what it comes down to. And as far as people that believe in evolution, that's fine. But think about this for a second. Myself, I grow a lot of fruits and vegetables. You know, you're required, for example, plums. You have a Santa Rosa plum. You're required to have another different type of plum to pollinate your Santa Rosa plum. That requires a bee. So how does evolution know this? You will not have plums if you don't have a bee to pollinate from tree to tree. That tells you something right there. And it just so happens fruits and vegetables has everything we need to sustain ourselves. You know, and there's protein, you know, and fiber in fruits and vegetables, specifically vegetables, but you don't get the fiber in meat. You just get the protein. So that tells you that, you know, fruits and vegetables have more benefits than just the meat alone. So,
well, thank
you. I'm not going to go on a tirade about pushing not eating meat, but me, I'm almost 44 years old, never been to the hospital. I avoid all sodas. I avoid what they push. Whatever they push, I'm not buying. Yeah. And it's that simple. You know, well, like, go ahead, Doug. Go ahead.
See, I think it comes down to a bit of balance, man, you know, and right now at this moment in time that we're in, as I've expressed before, we don't have the compass for the full objective facts of this reality, this existence, what's acceptable, what's not acceptable. So I think it comes right now at this moment in time, it comes down to personal choice. And I'm in total agreement, you know, from my stance and my personal life right now, I don't agree. You know, I see sentient beings and I don't think that they're a commodity. They should be a commodity for us to, you know, just use and abuse whatever way we see fit. I think it'd be hugely important if people were meat eaters that they get through the process themselves. I think that the industry has turned the whole thing into an absolute horror show, and I certainly don't agree with it, and I don't want to contribute to it in any way, shape or form. The evolutionary thing, for me, I think the kind of neo-Darwinian idea of evolution, I think, is total bunkum, total fucking lunacy. But I think there's certain aspects of evolution that I think have merit, adaptation, and maybe some of the mechanisms that are involved that have been overlooked and turned into something else, like, you know, natural selection and all these kind of mechanisms that they come up with. I think will and intent has a huge role to play in it. So the necessity for certain things, the will through an animal's life, the desires, whatever it's requiring, would bring about, you know, micro evolution, adaptation. But the macro evolution, right back to abiogenesis, I think is just total fucking hogwash. And I don't think it should be that hard for people to work that out, you know?
Yeah, well, you know, as simple as this, the way I look at it is like this. You know, it's nothing new. People say, if they're, you know, if we came from monkeys, why they're still monkeys? We always been humans and always will be. We're not going to evolve into anything else. So, I mean, the microevolution, there's adaptation, but there's no evidence of macroevolution. They're desperate to make us believe that, but there's nothing to it. You know, it's like this. Of course, in the public school system, which is really the government school system, they just cleverly disguise it by calling it public. They're pushing evolution. They're pushing it. So, you know, for example, like I said so many times, if they tell us the sun is 93 million miles away in deep space with no oxygen, you know, it's much closer and much smaller. So everything's on opposites. Whatever they tell us, you know, it's the exact opposite, because the mind can't go from A to Z. Once you're taught A, it can't go to Z. That's why it's always this, the law of reversal on opposites.
I think that's true in certain cases, but I wouldn't apply that to every single aspect. I would always sift through and
try. The foundations, I would say.
All right, yeah. That's definitely a rule, a tactic that they use. So I would agree with that, but I wouldn't apply it to every single thing. I would still think people should be discerning and try and understand each topic and subject that you get involved in, rather than just jumping to a conclusion.
You know? Well, Del, I'll say this, Del. It's like this. They'll lie to us about us coming from primates or monkeys, but they're not exactly lying to us how the body works. So I'm not saying they're working on opposites with that, but the foundation of we came from an explosion, which explosions destroy things, doesn't create things. So that's, but like I said, when the foundation's a lie, pretty much everything else after that's a lie as well. There's no truth in a lie. But like I said, if everything was an absolute lie, it'd be easy to detect. So, you know, it's a clever of mixing truth and lies. So the foundation of how we came about, but they can't lie how blood works and how our heart pumps and how our organs work. No, but the foundation of how it all started, how it created, you know. And like, for example, you have a coelacanth fish that was supposedly extinct for millions of years. There's fossils supposedly 350 million years old, but you still have the coelacanth fish living today in the Indian Ocean, which is identical to the fossils that are supposedly millions upon millions of years old. So,
I was just going to say, I think people overlook fossils and the, you know, if fossils being real fossils, how that would actually happen, and it would have to happen through rapid burial. You know, an animal dying on the surface of the earth. You know, Disney fossilized things are fossilized through rapid burial. And I've seen some religious people use that as a possibility to back up the idea of a kind of catastrophic flood. And for me, you know, I look at some of that evidence and it kind of points to that, like the petrified trees, fossils, these different things. But the way they're attaching it to the, as I say, the neo-Darwinian evolutionary story, I think it's just total hogwash. But there's some stuff there that I think that merits people's investigations. That may tell a different story to what they're actually pushing, you know.
Well, you see some of these petrified trees standing straight up.
Yeah.
Tell it's wrapped. And the thing is this: if it's, you know, each layer of this so-called sediment it's around, how is the top portion of this tree that's standing straight up surviving as the bottom portion is slowly petrified into fossil? So the top of the tree should not be there. That's just proof that it's, you know, basically it was all buried at once,
yep.
You know, and that's as simple as that. So bottom line, there's even a cowboy's boot that's fossilized. So the whole idea of fossils being millions upon millions of years old, and that's what they push. We have to understand. It's that simple. They're pushing this world is millions and millions of years old. You know, it's the opposite.
Yeah.
You know, it's the opposite when that's what they're pushing. You know, so there's no God.
It just all adds to the situation that we're in. We really don't know anything. And I think the sooner people stop clutching at hypothetical stories and historical stories and start getting real, then we may make some progress. But right now, you know, these ideas, concepts of should we eat meat, should we treat animals like this, all these moralistic and ethical things, but they belong right now in a subjective aspect to different individuals. In regards to the whole objective truth, I don't have any answers to that, so I can't make any decisions. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, I just see, you know, for example, just to feed an animal, how much water it takes, it is taking away. It takes so much away where it's unbelievable. People don't grasp that aspect either, to feed them, to give them water and all that. Yeah. But like I said, the bottom line is whatever they're preaching, you know, whatever, it's like this. I want to mention this as well, where science is deceiving the masses, where these organized religions and the churches, the big churches, the televangelists are definitely part of the deception as well. So if the right one doesn't get you, the left one will, and they're both just giving you partial truth. And of course,
something like the meat industry, you know, people would talk about these things and say, oh, it was an agenda like we're talking about right now. But the fact of the matter still lies that people would have had to have bought into these things in order for it to flourish in the first place. So it's difficult to see whether or not, you know, something like the meat industry just has ended up the way it is through demand and people wanting the product rather than it being an agenda. Do you know? I think the agenda aspect comes because people are trying to preserve their power, their monetary gain through the meat industry, so they will advertise it, they will push it. But how did it get to that point in the first place?
Yeah, well, that's from those that run this world. But I put it this simple. If you go to a doctor, which I've never been to a doctor my whole entire life, I'm almost 44 and don't need one, and tell them like on my deathbed that maybe I'll go see one. But the bottom line is this, if you go to a doctor, the ordinary person that sees a doctor, you know, they're never going to tell you, oh, you're eating too much fruits and vegetables, lay off. They'll tell you you're eating too much meat, you need to cut back, you know. Yeah. And so that tells you right there. No doctor tell you, you know what, I'm sorry, but you're eating too many vegetables, you got to cut back. You never hear that. So that's a clear-cut sign. To me, it's very simple. But I'm not here to preach. And, for example, I go with friends, and they might consume a steak and shrimp dinner while I'm having my vegetarian meal. So I'm willing to accept people's – I'm not like a snob with it. I can't stand vegan and vegetarian snobs. They wear their vegan shirts. I don't believe in that crap. To me, that completely turns me off to it. Don't do that. You come off as like you're whole and high, you know, high and holy. Don't do that. You're going to push people away. So, you know, I'm very – like accepting of everybody has their own choices to do what they do. You know, I'll go to someone, they'll have a, you know, like I said, a meat pizza, and I'll have a veggie pizza, and we'll talk, no problem. You know, so keep it simple like that.
I think it all comes down to transparency, as I say. You know, offer the kids the option and show them the reality of the situation and let them make their own minds up. And again, it just comes down to the subject of preference, and that's it. I prefer not to contribute to it, you prefer not to contribute to it. And that's fine. That's the walk that I'm going to walk and the walk that you're going to walk. If people can want to continue to be involved in it, then that's their choice. I'm not going to try and preach to them or convert them in any way, shape, or form, you know?
Yeah, that's the whole thing is, we all have our own free will to do as we please. And, you know, we could present things to people, but it's like this, you know, if you're over at my house and I have a plate of food in front of push a plate of food in front of you, and I say, hey, Del, you got to eat this. You're like, get that the hell away from me. If I say, hey, Del, here's a plate of food. If you want it, you can have it. If you don't want it, don't worry about it. You're more likely to try it. You know, you're more likely to sample it. But, you know, it's all about, you know, the way you present things, the way you do things. So we got to be careful, you know. But I wouldn't want to compare it to, say, a flat earth, because this is something where, you know, this is very important. The truth of how we're being deceived in so many levels, you know. And it's to keep us all dumbed down and away from the truth. You know, and I said this too. This is so important. And this is worth repeating when it comes to someone like Dr. Oz, who pushes vaccines to millions upon millions of his followers, his watchers. But he can't convince his own wife and children to get vaccinated. He said on CNN, when I come home, I'm Dr. Oz. I'm no longer Dr. Oz. I'm Mr. Oz. And my children and my wife, they don't do it. They don't get vaccinated. So he can't convince his own wife and children, but he can convince millions upon millions of people of his viewers to do it. So to me, it's just screams red flags, and it's completely ridiculous how people – to me, it's like this. I believe in a creator, and the creator created everything around us that we need, fruits, vegetables, to sustain us. We don't need this man-made garbage. Like I said, when it comes to sodas, I don't drink the aspartame diet sodas. I don't drink high fructose corn syrup sodas. I drink water. None of the above. What they offer, do not take, do not accept. You know, so to me, everything we need, eat things in the most natural form. When you cook vegetables, barely cook it, just like broccoli. Just steam it for a few minutes. If you want to boil corn, you'll turn on the heat, boil the water, turn it off, then throw the corn in there for a few minutes. Don't keep it on heat. After it's just a little bit cooked, you take it out. You still have it's still a little bit soft, but it's still tender enough to eat. So that's the way I see things. And I always say, keep everything simple. A lot of people try to make, like, for example, you know, diets and flat earth very complex and complicated. It's not. Keep it basic so everybody can understand it.
Yeah, I think it's important for people to understand that as well, that you don't adopt you know, if somebody's putting an eating plan up there on YouTube or whatever it may be, each individual is different. The whole point is that people have to experiment themselves, find out what works for them and pursue their own endeavours rather than listening to somebody else's advice or somebody else's walk and then trying to adopt that. People can take these different bits of information and then apply it to their own life and see what works for them. See how their body reacts, what they're missing, what you know, how it responds. And that's purely it. I think too many people get caught up in, you know, the group mentality of, oh, well, this vegan guru on YouTube does this, that, and the other, so I'm going to do that, you know. And then,
followers.
Yeah, you have to walk your own walk and find out what works for you. That's usually
You just hit the nail on the head there, Dell. There's people that are so used to being followers of the mainstream that when they shut off the mainstream, they become followers, and they're not free thinkers, or like they're locked into a channel. And I'm saying question everything. What I present, you know, what everybody presents, and come to your own conclusion based on all the information that's out there. We can make mistakes too.
Exactly. It's just like you're saying just now, you're talking about your experience, and people are going to misinterpret that and say, oh, RussianVids is saying that everybody should just eat vegetables and we're not allowed to eat meat. But that's not what's being said. You know, somebody like yourself is expressing their own experience and sharing that with people, and it's up to anybody else if they want to experiment in that avenue or not. It's not that anybody here is claiming that that's what we should and shouldn't be doing, because as I keep saying, none of us have the objective facts of our reality. The bigger picture of what should be done here, if this is where we're supposed to be, if this is all that exists, how we should live our lives, how we should apply ourselves morally, ethically, how we should treat them. None of us have any of the facts of that. You know, it's all just subjective. So nobody here is, and RussianVids is no saying that either, that everybody should just stop eating meat. You know, listen to what individuals are saying and don't misinterpret it, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And if someone wants to attempt it, I'm not forcing on them. If you're going to try it, it's like quitting cigarettes. You're not going to smoke two packs or 2 packs a day, for example, then go from smoking none. You got to do a slow breakaway. And I'm nothing to point at you, Dubs. I know you're having a little smoke right now, but no worries about that. But I'll just say this. If you're going to do it, do a slow breakaway. Stop, for example, stop eating beef and then just eat chicken, consume chicken and fish, and then do a slow breakaway. But if you don't want to do it, that's up to you. I am not like Dell said, I'm not here to force anybody. And I just talk about this topic a little bit. I don't harp on it. I don't put myself as like some vegetarian channel or some vegan channel. This is just something I do. And like I said, I've been out to dinner with people that eat meat. I don't give them a hard time about it. That's their choice. We can't force that.
It's a choice. You know? It has to be an educated choice. You know, it's not through ignorance. But like again today, I seen another video, you know, baby chicks born on mass scale, like you would not believe, and the treatment of these wee, you know, innocent animals who are at the most vulnerable point of their life, and they're just being manhandled and mistreated. And for me, subjectively, my morals, my ethics just can't contribute to that. I can't allow that to happen. So it comes down to people are living in ignorance, eating these products without any awareness of what's actually going on, and I think that's detrimental and a huge part of the problem. People should be given the full facts. Things should be transparent and open to children. We shouldn't be wrapping children up in cotton wool and hiding these things from them. Give them the full facts. Let them see the scope of the full situation and let them make their own choices. And someday for me, you know, that's what I'm saying. I'm not going to take my kids to eat chicken nuggets and these things when I look at the treatment that these animals have to go through, because how can we ever expect to hold ourselves in any regard or expect higher beings or any other being to treat us with any kind of respect when we don't even respect the other sentient life that's run about us? I think it's fucking absolutely ridiculous, you know?
I agree. And everybody
here. Victims, yet they don't give a fuck about the other sentient life that's run about them being treated like shit every single day.
Yeah. I agree 100%. You're on it 100%. And, you know, like I said, you know, we should be on the same path, but it's okay if we don't agree on everything. There's no two people will agree. It's literally impossible for you and I. We agree on a lot of stuff, but we're not going to see eye to eye on everything. But you know, bottom line is the main topics. We don't live in a freaking spinning ball. We're not monkeys living on a spinning ball. You know, when you fly anywhere, you know, for example, here's a better example. You know, for example, you're enjoying a nice day out, a summer day. There's a light breeze coming from the north. How the hell are we spinning, you know, east to west, you know, it's just ridiculous. If you get a light breeze, you see water like glass. You can go to like a lake and the water's like glass. We're supposed to be traveling 70,000 miles an hour, spinning 1,100 miles an hour. You throw a little pebble in that lake with that glass and you can make a ripple. The speed we're traveling has no effect. So again, everything on opposites. If they tell us we're freaking, it's mockery. I don't want to get too religious, but the Bible says how we're flat, basically flat, stationary. We're not moving. We're fixed on a foundation. And they tell us the opposite. We're not only not stationary, we're not only traveling 70,000 miles an hour, we're spinning too. So they're making it more ridiculous. You know, it's like the complete opposite. So I tell people, whatever they tell us, you know, whatever they're pushing, it's the exact opposite. And I have to stress this about the churches. They make it so uncomfortable to go in that direction of believing in a creator because they're so ridiculous with their goofy haircuts, their goofy hairstyles, and they're throwing the jackets around, hitting people. They never expose any of the psyops. They never expose any of the hoaxes. And they just go along, oh, those poor children at Sandy Hook or these poor children in Florida. And I want to mention this today right now, Dell, is they have this March for Our Lives. And they have this concept that's being floated around. It's on CNN right now where they talk about how, you know, the march is called wear the evil eye gloves. And if you look at it, it's the all-seeing eye on these gloves. And if you look at the all the symbols, it's obviously the all-seeing eye. Just like when you go to Masonic Lodge and they have the all-seeing eye of Lucifer on the top of their gloves. And it reminds me going back to Sandy Hook, where they had that one promotion with, it was called the Remember Sandy Hook, Race for Chase. Yeah. And it's all in blue and white. And you see the child doing the all-eye symbol, the single eye, the all-seeing eye. So this is like, you know, this is like history repeating itself. And why does history repeat itself? Because the same ones behind the scenes, they love to repeat history. Just like I said so many times, why do so-called celebrities die in threes? They don't die in threes. They're hoaxed in threes. They go into retirement out of the public eye, you know? These famous people like Bowie and all, Robin Williams, they don't want to deal with, I don't want to sound derogatory, dumbed-down sheep that don't know the truth of this world. They want to go to their own place where they're away from all the people that are dumbed down. And they're living their life. And they always tell us in these goofy cartoons like The Simpsons, Family Guy, how they're going to die. Like Chris Cornell, he has an album with him being hung, you know, and he supposedly, you know, gets hanged, you know, hangs himself. And then you have, you also have, what's his name? Nirvana, Kurt Cobain, all those photos with the gun on his head. And ends up killing himself supposedly later. It's all like revelation of the method. They're telling us what they're going to do before they do it. You know, they're showing us.
Maybe they're away onto some other pond that's a nice oasis away from all us fucked up crazies, you know? Maybe that's what they are.
They are. Well, John Lennon said John Lennon was no hero, but he said, I think we're run by a bunch of psychopaths.
Of course.
You know, I wonder what, you know, but he was no hero either, but like Albert Pike once stated, of course, the highest degree of Freemason in the U.S. history. They have a statue of him right now in the Washington and mausoleum as well. You know, former KKK man and attorney, soldier, all this stuff. You know, and he says, you know, when the people need a hero, we'll create one for them. So yeah. They control all sides. Anybody that's propped up in this world, you know, it's an elevated Mason, just playing a role in the world stage. So just like Alex Jones. You know, David Icke never called anything. He never called any of these events out as a hoax.
No.
You know, this guy from Natural News, that guy, what's his name? Michael Adams. I forgot his name. I think it's Michael Adams. He's saying people, really real people died in these events. So again, it makes each other lie type of thing where they're keeping people away from the truth, just like the churches. So I understand where a lot of people, you know, that are awake, they turn a blind eye to the church. I don't blame them because they're just as controlled as science is.
It comes down to something you said 5 minutes ago. What people have to do is separate subjective from objective, and anybody who's involved in truth seeking has to be able to discern and separate these two things. And always, if we're going to be any kind of community, we have to agree to be representing what we can prove objectively true and separate the subjective aspects and leave them, you know, as subjective. And then things would be cleared up and less muddy, as far as I'm concerned, you know?
Yeah, I agree, Del. Here's the thing, too, is I've done a lot of videos covering a lot of events before they were so-called popular with the so-called conspiracy theorists, like the SFO plane crash hoax, where I call it a hoax, and people are yelling and screaming at me on my channel, saying, "Oh, I don't see an agenda behind it." Then what you saw, what did you see after the fact? All these plane crash hoaxes proceeding right after that. Then they move from plane crashes to people getting beat up in airplanes. Yeah. So the theme of you know, the airplane and the fear factor and with all that. So when you're the first to call something out, like when you know, people were jumping aboard the truth bandwagon when it came to 9/11, a lot of people were saying, "Oh, there were real planes used." When you were the first one, when someone was the first one to say, "Oh, no planes were used," "Oh, you're a crackpot. What's wrong with you?" You know, it's whenever you're the first to call something out, you're gonna be, you know, you're gonna be like looked at as they're gonna look at you sideways. So, but we said that when we see the truth, we shouldn't be afraid to pull it out. And if people might not see it now, they'll look back and say, "Oh, you know, Dell was right, or RussianVids was right on this." So we should not be afraid or altered by public opinion. Just look at the Hitler rallies, where all these, you know, it looks like hundreds. I'm not saying it's 100,000 people, but it looks literally like hundreds of thousands of people at these rallies, as far as the eye can see. And all these people are convinced that this man's legit and real. It's just easy to fool people. It's just hard to convince them they're being fooled. It's very difficult to convince them they're being fooled. And again, going back to what you do, going on this, you know, hitting the streets and educating people about the flat earth reality, I commend that. You know, that takes a lot of balls, you know, and a lot of people, you know, they don't, you know, make that effort, or, you know, they just, you know, they watch videos and, you know, they'll talk amongst, you know, other people on YouTube. But, you know, I really commend you for doing what you're doing all the way around. And your channel's not fluffy. It's not butterflies and kittens. You hit hardcore, and you're kind of like a roughneck kind of guy. I'm sure, you know, in your past, you might have roughed up some people. You're not like it's kind of a wimpy guy. And we need that. We need somebody with balls to tell these people the truth. You know, you can't be so nice about it sometimes either.
So, well, everybody's got the different aspects that I think are useful, just as we were talking about with Josh, authentic intent there. You know, everybody's got different attributes, and that can only be me and contribute to the whole in whatever way I can, but it doesn't mean that me, you, or Josh is any better than anybody else. Everybody's got something to offer, and you know, whatever it is, people just need to be active and voice, and as you say, stand up, have a bit of balls and backbone, and stand up and represent yourself, regardless of who you are. You don't have to be brash and bold and sweary like me and aggressive. You know, people can be a different demeanor to them, but still achieve, you know, the same thing. So everybody has attributes that I think contribute to it, mate, you know?
Yeah, I think so. I agree. And you know, the thing is, the main thing is, However which way you go about it, be confident what you're saying. Look these people dead in the eye. Yeah, talk to them. Show them you know what you're talking about. I'm not a crazy man. You're not talking to a crazy man. Tell them you're being deceived. And look at them with firmness. Don't need to be, you know, for example, your approach or my approach, I don't really curse. You know, that's me. But I'm very confident in what I know. I've done a lot of research. Where these people we talk to, they've done absolutely none. They've done no research at all. You know, I want people to look at this one album. If they go to Google Images, and you as well, Del, if you can, please. It's called Passport Infinity Machine. Passport Infinity Machine. And tell me what you see there, Del.
I'm just typing it in just now.
Yeah, just take no worries. Just when it pops up and you go to Google Images and you see that album cover. Yeah.
Yes.
You see the cube. Now, if you show that to someone, they'll say, "Oh my goodness, that looks completely ridiculous to believe that." But it's not too far off from the ball earth. Just trim away the corners. You got your freaking ball earth.
What's up? So,
you know what I mean? And even more ridiculous is you can imagine the very bottom, Antarctica. Mm-hmm. So put this in people's minds, or, you know, just imagine you chip away at the corners and you get your ball.
I've said that to people before. I could just remove the globe and place a cube in there. And say, "Oh, well, you don't realize that you're going over the corner because you're so small in comparison to the corner." I mean, it's just the same. You could put any shape in there and convince people that that's what we're living on.
You know what, Dale? I'll tell you this, too. A lot of people are missing the boat when it comes to talking about flat earth. People that believe in the flat earth. Keep it this simple. Like, people say, "Oh, I see the buildings," like, say, the Chicago skyline, and you only see a portion of the buildings. And that, to them, that proves we live in a ball, because you only see, like, say, half or three quarters, whatever, of the buildings. very important point, is of course, if that was true, then the billion should be tilting away. Why are they freaking still pulling straight up? If well, that's what you're referring to.
The other aspects of that is that you never see it left to right over a greater distance. And, you know, if you were to elevate a camera focused on that horizon point, as you elevate, the camera would continually have to angle downwards to keep up with the horizon, which should be sloping away from you as you elevate, but it never does. You know, you elevate that camera, the horizon's going to come up behind those buildings that you thought was hidden by curvature. So,
yeah, absolutely. And those simple points, there are people who are yelling and screaming at each other in the chat of these kind of videos. Just point that out. That's one thing they cannot deny. They've never seen a freaking building tilt ever, ever. The only way is, and I covered this a long time ago, like what was it, 2015 or so, I made a video where they did a documentary on the spire and the World Trade Center, the so-called Freedom Tower, where there's programming within programming where they're talking about the Freedom Tower, and they have all these visuals of the construction worker climbing the spire, and you can see the so-called curvature of the earth, but he's obviously using a fisheye lens where the lens is flexing, where sometimes it looks like a ball, sometimes it's convex. It's completely convex. And you know, and same thing with jet fighters. I made a video about that as well, where Joe Rogan had that one goofball from that show Jackass. I forgot his name, but that one skinny guy that's always on crack talking about how people that believe in the flat earth are a bunch of effing morons and this and this. You know, and this crackhead's trying to preach to us, we're living in a ball. And they're talking about these jet fighters that go, you know, these high altitudes, what is it? I don't know, 40, 50,000 feet, because you can see the earth as a ball. Well, I have made a video about that as well, where you can see, you know, the convex, the flex of the camera lens. You see the ball? Yes, you see the ball, but also convex. And you see that, and I pause it right where the lens is, you know. And you see it right there in front of you. What people want to see, what they want to see, and they ignore the rest. You know, Dell, I spent a lot of time researching this before I jumped on this. I didn't just like on a whim said, "Oh, I'm going to be in this flat Earth." I did a lot of research, a tremendous amount before I put myself out there, one way or the other. You know, and that's fine. These people behind the scenes that don't have their mind made up, but a lot of people are going to reject it before the evidence is even produced to them. So to them, we're wasting our time with them. We move on to the people that do care about the truth.
It's just as you said at the beginning, and I've experienced that so much in my pursuits, that it's astonishing how little people actually know about the claimed model that they assume and believe to be true. So if they don't even know anything about what they actually believe in, then they're not going to be open to anything contrary to that, because they don't even understand what their own assumptions are. You know, so it's a difficult process with some people.
Yeah, you know, here's another thing too. When you go to university or college and you confront these students there, their so-called higher level of education, they're spending a whole lot of money to be basically indoctrinated, so they're going to really fight. It's like you're telling me I'm being lied to? You're telling me I'm deceived? How dare you? That's what their subconscious is saying to themselves. And you can see their faces.
Go ahead. One of the last times when Gav was here, we went to Glasgow University again, and that was one of the responses where we asked a question, and it was, I don't know the answer to that, but I'm sure there's a book that can give me the answer. And, right there and then, and that's somebody who's in the higher education aspect of it that's saying these things. I don't have an answer to that. I don't understand it, but I'm sure there's a book that has the answer. Like, wow.
You know, Dale, that's I find that hilarious and sad at the same time. What these people don't understand is these so-called teachers, professors, they're taught to teach directly out of these books. They cannot deviate. They cannot put up a second theory. They cannot deviate for a second. If they do, they're out of a job. That simple. Actually, I have a friend that's big in a flat earth as well, and he had an argument with his professor about the so-called moon landing. And he was told that the professor looked him dead in the eye, and he winked at him. He goes, "Greg, I'm here to teach out of the textbooks." And he winks. He's telling him, "Hey, I'm just doing my job. And I might agree with you, but I cannot go there because I don't want to put myself out there." But basically telling him, you know, "Hey, I'm with you, but I can't go there." That kind of thing.
Cult practices, you know. It's the cult teachings, and that's what's to be taught, and that's it.
Yeah, exactly. it's, you know, it's hard. It's like I said so many times, it's like, you know, a CD-ROM, once it's pressed, it cannot be changed. We must be like a rewritable CD-ROM where we can be record. You can press over it, you know, forget what we learn and start over. That's another thing I want to tell people too, is, you know, some people are first awakening to this world deception, and they'll grasp some of the lies, but they don't realize how many lies. And from the Trayvon Martin case to the LAX shooting hoax to the so-called ball we're living on, and the sun somehow burning in deep space with no oxygen, and all this rubbish, you know. It's like that song from Meatloaf. I said it a million times. Everything is a lie, and that's a fact. Life's a lemon. I want my money back. So they put the truth. That's another, you know, truth in lies, truth in movies, and music, and lies in the news. The world of opposites. Everything's an opposite. Where no one's going to believe, oh, it's just a song. Like the 21st century blues. How can we believe the earth is round? I just can't believe it. I just can't conceive it. It's all a big lie. But it's just a song. Do you think this band, we're sitting around, you know, the dinner table, saying, hey, let's sing a song about how we can't believe the earth is round. We just can't believe it. We just can't conceive it. It's given to them to mock. It's full of mockery. So it's like this too. And I try to explain this to people that are new to truth, that keep on talking about, like, Robbie Parker at Sandy Hook, and how he's smiling, and how they bust him. They caught him live. No, that was their intent, for him to come out at that angle, for him smiling. How do I know that? When he's leaving the funeral, he has a big smile on his face as well. So you see him smiling before the press conference, the next day after the supposed shooting, and the day after, or the day of the funeral, he has a big smile on his face. So they're telling you, they're mocking. And listen, they're telling the truth, not through words. They don't communicate through, you know, the Masonic handbook. You know, they learn how to speak. They learn how to communicate without speaking. It leaves you signs, symbols, dates, numbers, and colors. They're telling you without speaking, this is all rubbish. Look at the man's face. He's smiling. He's telling you right there, it's rubbish. But he's not saying it with words. So there you go. You know? That's how they do it.
Exactly.
So, you know, sorry if I keep going on and on, but there's so much to cover. There's so many lies, and there's so many, I hate to say it, so many brainwashed people out there. They cannot even conceive how deep it goes. And the deeper you go, the crazier you're going to sound. And then they start running because their mind, it's like the old future shock, where the human mind can't absorb so much at one time. It becomes flooded with new data, and they go bonkers and they just run off. So we have to introduce all this new information slowly. That's why Flat Earth is very important, but I wouldn't start someone else new on that right away. I would start off, your news is fabricated. Look where they're lying here. Look where they're news repeaters. We've seen all those videos of them repeating the same script. Yeah. You know, I tell this to people, you know, real quick. I tell this to people all the time, where you have all these people at CNN, Fox News, BBC. They're sitting, you know, behind a desk, reading off a teleprompter. They're not there. It's not their words. These words of supposedly what went down are given to them. They're just script readers. They're not news people.
That's it. Trained in NLP, they just read the story, they know how to affect people with the right facial expressions and the smile at the right moment, the serious demeanor at the right moment. It's all just play acting, you know.
Here's one thing that I want to throw at you. You know, a lot of these so-called shootings and these bombing events, I always say it, you can't fake real. Where are the freaking tears? Even if there's no tears, where's the redness around the eyes?
Yeah.
You know, where's the snot coming out of the nose? There's none of this. But I watched local news of this one black woman, and her son was shot. She's snot bubbling and tears rolling down her face continuously. You never see it with national and international news stories. You never see it. But see, that's become normal, because that's all people see. So to them, this is normal behavior, to have no tears. Everybody grieves differently. No, everybody grieves the same on TV. It's all the same. You know, real smiling and fake crying. So, you know, it's really, you know, I get very passionate about this, because to me, it's so obvious. And I want to mention this too, how they love to put the truth in movies, with that movie They Live, where the black preacher man, who's blind, he cannot see, literally, he cannot see, he's blind, but he's telling people how they've been blinded to the truth. People around them have eyes to see, but they cannot see. People have eyes, but they cannot see. They have a brain, but do not use it.
That's
society. Just regurgitate what you're told. Repeat what you heard off TV. Repeat what you read off the textbooks, and you're intelligent in this society. And that's the problem. That's the major problem. Nobody questions anything.
Keep up that passion, mate. You know, it's always a good thing to have. And keep pursuing it and putting out there what you're putting out. So you've got a new channel, you're saying?
Yeah, I just put it up a little while ago. I only have one video of me speaking because after I covered the Las Vegas shooting hoax, they terminated my channel. I tried more than, I would say, maybe 7-8 times to start new channels. Every time they're shut down, but there's with me speaking. So I'm like riding a very thin, skating on thin ice. I got to be very careful what I put out and what I say and my titles and all that. So, I think I just got to be very careful, of what I do. And I'm going to try to put some good videos out there, but just keep the title vague where it's not going to raise any red flags. Because the most important truth, like, for example, I don't mean to toot my own horn, but back in 1996, they had the so-called Atlanta bombings where I put out a video where people were covering a lot of newer events. I said, this is going back further. And so I go back in time and I look at other events. In 1996, the so-called Atlanta bombings, I see a freaking cop show up at the scene where nobody has blood on them but him. The cop himself has blood on his left hand. He's covering with his right hand. He goes around smearing on people, and it's right there for everybody to see.
That's the problem with the TV, though. People are more critical while they're watching it. They go into autopilot mode. They believe the narrative and they're not discerning and looking for any flaws or... That's why it's good to bring awareness to these things, because hopefully it triggers people into that so that they're not passively looking at the screen. They're actually analysing what they're seeing and what they're hearing and trying to piece it together. That makes a huge difference.
Well, there's many other dots to connect besides but what they see, what's on paper. For example, the so-called Atlanta bombing, the so-called Unabomber, the Susan Smith case, Joker Tsarnaev, Jared Lee Loeffner, the Zachary Massawi trial. They all had the same freaking lawyer, Judy Clark, for all these hoaxes, all these psyops. And that's something I want to say too. These events, they fabricate them. Where the public, general public's deceived, so are so-called conspiracy theorists. I call them false flags. They don't kill people during these events. Yes, they kill people through fluoride, through all the chemicals they put in our foods, preservatives. But with these events, they want both the conspiracy theorists to be off and the people that believe the news to be off. It's none of the above. And I said this a million times. And people, this is the grand illusion where the world's a stage. And on a stage, in a world stage, if the world's a stage, they don't kill people like Gaddafi, stage, Hitler, stage, Bin Laden, staged. They freaking said they threw him over the carrier after they killed him in Pakistan. Stage. Saddam Hussein. And I mentioned, it's very important, I want to repeat this, where they said they found him in that hole. The U.S. Marines found him in that hole, and they pulled him out, this big fat guy, hiding in this little this hole, this rat hole. And right behind him is a date tree, a date palm tree, where those fruits only appear July and August. I'm a gardener, and I know how certain fruits fruit only specific times of the year. Those dates only fruit July and August, and then it's impossible. It is literally impossible for fruit to show up, those dates to show up on the tree, September, October, November, December, beyond, until the next year. That date palm is full of fruit. That tells you they filmed that segment that supposedly went down in December back in the summer. That's telling you Saddam Hussein's part of it as well. Yeah. You see all the photos of Saddam Hussein shaking hands with Rumsfeld in the early 80s, okay? Yeah. You see, like Tony Blair, in the UK, of course, shaking hands with Gaddafi, and you see a Masonic handshake. The world's a stage.
Of course. They're not going to get into any positions if they're not part of the club, I don't think anybody should be struggling with that concept or idea at this moment in time. I think it's pretty much obvious. It's who you know, and if you're part of it, then you're in,
Yeah. Yeah. It's like the nuclear threat with Russia. Just a fear. It was fear-based. With Russia and the U.S., just like they're repeating history with North Korea now. Every freaking week, they come out, the leader says in the North Korea, we have nuclear warheads aimed at the U.S. And nothing ever is going to happen, of course. Just like with the Cold War, it's fear equals control. Just like the movie, The Road Warrior, where the Lord Humongous is holding Wes in that one scene, and Wes wants to get revenge for his slain friend who got hit in the head with a boomerang, and he goes, "Be still, my dog of war. We'll have our revenge. Fear. We'll use fear as our ally." And this is a George Miller production with Mel Gibson and all and the whole crew, and they're telling you their concepts of how, you know, they use fear to control the masses in every which way. It, like the Ebola, like what happened to acid rain back in the 80s? It freaking disappeared. What happened to the so-called Ebola virus? You know, that just disappeared in a thin air. And people have such a short attention span. The largest supposed U.S. massacre with Las Vegas, it's gone. The story's gone. You know, it's just, it's all just, it's so easy to see. We live in this contrived lie system for those that are awake. And I get frustrated. You hear my voice. It's frustration because it's so freaking obvious to me. And to you, it's people like you. It's so obvious. Yeah. It's so obvious. And they use the same pattern over and over and over.
Exactly. Just hope people will snap out of the apathy.
Apathy.
And that fear aspect, you know, is drilled in through the family units as well. You know, people... The family units use intimidation and fear on their children in order to achieve certain goals. I'm not saying everybody does that, but it's there. It's part of the whole culture, you know.
Yeah,
do this or else. Do that or else. You know, it's fear is instilled through every aspect, not just from governments, but it's in the family unit. People need to realize these things are a lot closer to home than some external big bad guy. You know, they're contributing to it just the same as everybody else. So,
yeah, it's like just driving on the freaking freeway, you know, in the U.S. here, you know, approximately, you know, 35 to 40,000 people are killed a year annually, and you never hear that mentioned in the news, never. But they mention terrorist attack where nobody dies in this country, of course, from any terrorist attack, but that's what's always spilled out.
Yeah.
You know, if they're really concerned about us, they would talk about the freaking safety on the roads, but they're not concerned about that, of course.
Just like you were saying earlier, I used to think about these things years ago, when there was like certain other wars happening or different parts, where I could switch the TV on and it would be the news. And I used to think to myself, how did the camera crew know to be at that exact location to watch the bomb coming in and hitting? And how did they have different cameras at different angles, all pointed in that very same place, like they had prior knowledge that that's exactly what's going to happen? You know, there's loads of aspects that people should be picking up on. I don't think there's many people are in any doubt that it's a stage and all these things are being played out and acted out, you know?
Del, it's funny you mentioned that because I made a video a while back about the supposed battle with the Peshmerga on the border with Iraq and the so-called ISIS on the border. And it was covered by CNN. And you see all these civilians on the hillside with children, holding children, and they're all clapping during this supposed live battle and everything. And you look to the far right, you see a bunch of freaking cars parked there. Like these people were like called, summoned to be there to partake in this. But it's ridiculous to believe, you know, for example, these people on the side of the Peshmerga. What if the Peshmerga were wiped out and eliminated? What would the ISIS move in and simply slaughter all these civilians with their children? But nobody considers it. It's so transparent. It's so transparent, and people don't even consider this because, you know, the shock factor, like 9/11, people were petrified with fear after 9/11. They're taking karate classes. They're doing this. They're doing that. It's all a bunch of BS. 9/11 was nothing more than a controlled demolition of three buildings with a fantasy story wrapped around it. You know, I said it so many times, with the towers coming down after 33 years and the 33-year-old pilot with Muhammad Atta. Everything's coded. These are occultists, so they're going to have that number wrapped around it, too. It's, you know, there's so many agendas, not just one. It's the money. It's a ritualistic where, you know, after the, you know, it's like before the towers were built, they were planned to come down. Just like the groundbreaking for the Pentagon was 1941. You do the numbers to 2001. Just like Bush with the New World Order speech in 91. So you get all the ones in there. So all the years come up, and they do things by the numbers. From the Pentagon 1941 to the New World Order speech in 41 to the New World Order speech in 1991 to 2001. So by the numbers, just like the OJ case. And I was the first to make a video calling it a hoax where, you know, OJ was sued by the Goldman family for $33 million. Then 13 years to the day he was being acquitted, he was sentenced to prison for stealing back his own merchandise for 33 years. So people can't tell me they don't do things by the numbers. Yeah. This happened. Oh my gosh, what an amazing coincidence. And also, OJ, who was number 32 when he played football, American football, and he was, and it was funny, they had these guards on this one TV show, and they were talking about OJ and him supposedly being in prison. And while they're walking out of the prison, saying, isn't it amazing? What a coincidence. OJ's number 32, and he's in prison cell number 32, but he never spent a freaking day in prison. The only time he's in prison, when they film him there for that day, that he's out golfing or doing whatever, you know. And that's the thing is, when you see all these so-called celebrities, for example, some of them actually spot some out in public, but they're like, oh, no, that can't possibly be OJ because, you know, he's in prison. So it's someone that looks like OJ. He's wearing, guy's wearing a hat. You see him from a distance. Yeah. You know, and if you do mention him, if you do really see him, oh, it's just a lookalike, you know, and, you know, I don't want to be called crazy. So I'm not even going to mention anybody. So that's the bottom line is you know, this lie system. People can't wrap their brain around. And also regarding the OJ case, and I mentioned before where you have the DA, Gil Garcetti, who's currently right now, you can see him on the internet movie database. He's making movies and producing movies in Hollywood right now. Same with Marcia Clark. She was in a TV show called Pretty Little Liars. Another attorney for the prosecution, Christopher Darden, he was in a movie with Jim Carrey, a cameo appearance with the movie title Liar Liar. So you have Pretty Little Liars, you have Liar Liar, and Christopher Darden was asked during a CNN interview, what's the difference between being an attorney and being an actor? He goes, there's not much difference. We're both paid to, you know, each occupation you're paid to lie. Yeah, you know, yeah. So they're like rubbing your face as they lie. So yes. all these events, people say, why would they lie? Why would they fabricate the OJ case? Well, it's to divide and conquer. It successfully divided a nation, and not only the nation, but many people throughout the flat earth. Yeah. You know, so that's what it's about. You know,
distracted and divided, that's what I mean. But listen, man, I'm getting tired here. I'm going to shut up shortly. Oh, I appreciate you coming on, mate.
Thanks, Dale. Thank you for having me on. I appreciate you, man, and all your work you do. Fantastic.
Cool, mate. Yeah. Keep up. Keep spreading that passion, mate.
Thank you so much, Dale. You have a good one. Huh? You have a good night.
Cheers, buddy. Peace out. Take it easy.
You too. Thank you.
Right. Cheers, people. Marshall, there wasn't anybody else waiting there, was there?
We're going to have to disappoint a few people this evening, though. Yes, there is still plenty to...
I don't know if these people would maybe consider, you know, tomorrow or midweek, if that was any good. It's just that's 3 years now, so I'm getting to that point.
Yeah, no, I think people appreciate the fact that, you know, time's limited and stuff, and, you know, we'll always be back another day, right?
Well, apologies to anybody out there who was sitting waiting. As I say, I'm going to go for another wee session tomorrow afternoon. Failing that, I'll go midweek again. Just to remind people that there's a meeting on the 31st at the last post in Paisley at 1 p.m. Be good to see you there. So, but that's it for tonight. So, cheers, Marshall, Magumba, Jonah Worms, Dez, everybody who came on tonight, and everybody in the chat box. I'll see you very, very soon. Peace. Take it easy.